Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure for me to be here today, and thank you very much to the organizer for the invitation. I am not a specialist of energy, but my topic is more the climate, and I would like to demonstrate you that it's really important to decarbonize the energy to satisfy the Paris Agreement and to maintain the temperature, the global temperature, to less than 2 degrees, and if possible, to 10 to 1.5. And okay, I would like to present you the key messages of two important publications. The first one is, it's the report of the IPCC on the global warming of 1.5, which has been published. The summary for decision makers has been published 8th of October this year. And this important report demonstrate that it's really it is really a difference between a global warming of 1.5 and 2 degrees. And the second paper concerned more the Mediterranean and has been published by a group that I coordinate with my colleagues Wolfgang Kramer. It's called MEDEC. It's the climate impact on the Mediterranean region. And I will finish the presentation by present you this the objective of that group. The first this is the report which has been requested by the Paris Agreement conference, the COP21. It's a special report on the impact of global warming of 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels in related global greenhouse gas emission pathways in the context of the strengthening the global response to the threat of climatic change, sustainable development, and efforts to eradicate poverty. This report has been written by 91 authors from 40 countries, 133 contributing authors. It's based on 6,000 studies. It has been intensively reviewed by colleagues, and we have received more than 40,000 comments. And the main conclusion of the report is since the pre-industrial times, human activities has caused approximately a global warming of 1 degrees. This objective of 1.5 is not very far from us because we are already at 1 degree warming. And we see already the consequence for people, nature, and livelihood of that warming of 1 degrees. At the current rate, it's about 0.2 degrees per decade. The level of 1.5 degree will be reached between 2030 and 2051, 52, with a mean of about 2040. The human-induced global warming has already caused multiple observed change in the climate systems, in the ecosystems, and we have high confidence in that. As you know, the assertion of the IPCC report are always accompanied by a confidence level of the conclusion. And the impact of global warming at 1.5 are significantly lower than 2 degrees. There will be less extreme weather events where people live, including extreme heat and rainfall, especially for the Mediterranean, as I will show you after. The global mean sea level rise around 10 centimeters lower. Thus, we will save 10 centimeters of global sea level rise with 1.5 according to 2 degrees. And it concerns 10 million of people which will be less exposed to risk of raising seas. Half species, the report showed that about 15% of the species will be in danger with 2 degrees of warming, and the half of this 15% will be saved with 1.5 warming. Also for the permafrost, it's important for the future of the climatic change, because when the permafrost is melting, there is an important rejection of greenhouse gases, and it will cause later an additional global warming. And at 1.5, we will save 2 million of square kilometers of permafrost. And also an important consequence is the coral reefs, which will be saved of quasi-total decline at 1.5, and the decline will be very important at 2 degrees. And the second paper published by the consortium MEDEC, it's a review paper dedicated to the Mediterranean. It has been written by 15 authors from 9 countries, and it has been issued 1 month ago. And the topic of the paper, it's to show, it's a review paper, it's not a new result, but it's a synthesis, is to show that the climate change and interconnected risk to sustainable development in the Mediterranean. And the conclusion, it's that there is an accelerated climate change in the Mediterranean, with a change in land use, increasing pollution and declining biodiversity. We have distinguished 5 vulnerable domains: water, ecosystems, food, health, and security. The policies for sustainable development of the Med countries need to mitigate this risk, and energy is one of the methods to mitigate that. The lack of adequate information, particularly for the most vulnerable South and East Mediterranean countries, with fewer systematic observation and impact model. It's the reason, it's the main motivation of that group, it's to fill that gap for the Mediterranean. And if you look at that curve, here you have the in green the global warming of the warming of the globe. You see at the end of the 19th century, it is the reference, it's the pre-industrial time. We have a first warming here, stabilization here, and from the end of the 70s, we have a new global warming, and now we are at about one degree of warming, 1.1. It is for the globe, and if we look the same curve for the Mediterranean, you see that from the 90s, we have an acceleration of the warming in the Mediterranean, and now we can tell that the Mediterranean region is warming by 20% faster than the globe. The Mediterranean region is really a hotspot region, and it's really important to adapt and also to mitigate the climatic change. And the main conclusion is that even with a temperature of about 2 degrees, rainfall is likely to be reduced by 10 to 30%. It's really important because the region is already a relatively arid region. Irrigation will have to be increased by 4 to 20% to compensate the growing human population and the lack of precipitation. The sea level rise directly affects the Mediterranean because there is a lot of people on the coast, and this coast will be affected by storm surge. It's a reason why in the Mediterranean there is particularly vulnerable is because of the absence of tide. There is a lot of infrastructure and town at the sea level, which are built at the sea level. And the last conclusion is about the intrusion of salt water in many areas, such as the Nile Delta. And to summarize the risk at the global level before going to the Mediterranean level, we have here different domains where we can see the increased risk. When the risk is absent, it's a white color. When there is a moderate risk, it's a yellow. And when you have a purple color, that means that the risk is very important. For example, here, for the warm water corals, you see that we are at 1 degree, we are already at important risk. We estimate that 50% of the corals are now in danger. At 1.5, it will be between 70 and 90, and at 2 degrees, almost all the coral reefs will be in danger, in very important danger. For the mangrove, it's not so important. Between 1.5 and 2 degrees, there is not really a difference. For the fisheries, it starts to be important. At 1 degree, we are already in moderate risk. And at 1.5 and 2 degrees, it will be an important risk for the fisheries. For the Arctic region, especially the sea ice, you see that we have also important risk between 1.5 and 2 degrees. For the terrestrial ecosystems, the risk will be above, the maximum risk will be above 1.5. But for the risk, for the arid ecosystems, the risk is more important. For the coastal flooding, we are already in the red. For the fluvial flooding, it's not so important. We are still in the yellow. And for the crops, we estimate that the important risk will be above 2 degrees. For the tourism, it's more heterogeneous because in some place, tourism will gain from the global warming, and in other place, it will lose. And for the morbidity and mortality, especially due to heat waves, we are already in the yellow, and the risk will increase after. For the Mediterranean, I can summarize the gain to stay at a global warming of 1.5. It's an increase in probability of extreme drought. It's medium confidence. The reduction in runoff of about 9%, with here is the confidence interval, with medium confidence also, and the risk of water deficit, which are already present at 1.5, but there's a tree risk will be amplified at 2 degrees with an increased probability of extreme drought, reduction in runoff of 17% instead of 9%, and higher risk for water deficit. Thus, the Mediterranean region is particularly vulnerable and will particularly gain in limiting global warming. The decarbonization challenge is this very important. And now I would like to show you a few strategies which has been presented in the special report. The main conclusion is that to limit warming to 1.5 degrees, CO2 emission fall by about 40% by 2030. It's really important to reduce by about 45% the CO2 emission, this mainly by saving energy and decarbonization of the energy. And the reference is the level of 2010. And if we stay at a global warming of 2 degrees instead of 45%, it could be 20%. To limit the warming to 1.5, CO2 emission would need to reach the net zero around 2050. Thus, in this case, the emission of CO2 must be compensated by negative emission. And for 2 degrees, it will be 2075. And reducing non-CO2 emission would have a direct and immediate health benefits also. The pathway to try to attain this IPCC objective or the Paris Agreement objective, in fact, it's not an easy problem. The limiting warming to 1.5, it's physically feasible, but it will require a change on an unprecedented scale. Deep emission cuts in all sectors, a range of technology, behavioral change, increased investment in low carbon options. This, in fact, the effort must be put in a lot of different sectors. And to go in the good direction, in fact, it is estimated in this report that the part of the renewable energy in the mix, energy mix, will be between 49 and 67% of the total by 2050. The progress in renewable would need to be mirrored in other sectors. We would need to start taking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. This, it's not sufficient to limit the emission. It's also important to remove the CO2, which is already in the atmosphere. The implications for food security, ecosystem, and biodiversity are not negligible. The, you know that the countries at the Paris conference came with national pledges, the particular effort to reduce, and it is the NDC, they propose to reduce the emission with in the different domain. And if we put together all the national pledges, in fact, it's not enough to limit the warming to 1.5. It's more about 3 degrees at the moment. If the NDC are attained, it will be a warming of 3 degrees. It's much more than 2 degrees. And this is the way to go in that direction is still a long way. Avoiding a warming of more than 1.5 would require CO2 emission to decline substantially before 2030. And I would like to show you the different pathway which has been distinguished by the report. The first one is the, if you know, it's the best one to reach the Paris Agreement. And the last one, it's the most slow strategy. This, it will be more difficult to attain the Paris Agreement with that one. And the difference between the four pathway, it's in the speed to decrease the emission. If we are able to decrease the emission before 2030, yeah, like here, you see in gray, it is the emission due to fossil fuel and industry. And in orange here, it is the emission due to AFLU. AFLU is the forestation or deforestation and land use. When it is deforestation, you see it contributes to the emission. And when it is afforestation, it contributes to the absorption of CO2. And the last one is the technology, which is studied by the report, it's BECCS, it's bioenergy with a storage of the carbon. This is not enough to burn biomass to produce energy. It's also important to capture the CO2 in, for example, in the geological levels. This technology is maybe the most promising technology according to the IPCC report. But they propose to avoid the too big use of that technology by mainly using AFLU if we are able to work with the P1 and P2. If we are not able to reduce fast enough the emission, we will be able to increase the BECCS here in yellow. You see, it's this negative emission which are able to compensate the fact that there's still emission of CO2 after 2050. And here you see, we need a much more important removal methodology to compensate the fact that the emission will continue after 2050. This here it's four possible scenarios, and quicker when the reduction of the emission is very rapid from now, it will be easier to go to the zero emission in 2050. But if we are not able to remove it fast enough, we will need to use a technology to extract the carbon from the atmosphere. Now I finished with the network of MEDEC. MEDEC means a Mediterranean group of experts for climate and environmental change. And the objective of that group is to write in the first step a report, an assessment report of the climate change and impact on the Mediterranean basin. It's, at the moment, it's sponsored by different institutions, especially the Union for the Mediterranean. And this is the outline of the first report, which is issued, it is planned to be issued early 2020. We are now at the stage where we have the authors for all that points, and the authors has to provide the first draft before the end of the year. And the outline is first we have the driver of the environmental impact. The drivers are climatic, but also pollution, land and sea use and management, and invasive species. This we have a mix of science, physical and human and societal science. The third chapter, it's maybe the most important. It's the main challenge for the Mediterranean. And it is divided in three parts. The first one is the resource, water, food and energy. We have a working group who works on that. We have already a meeting, a workshop to start the writing of that part. The second, it's the ecosystems and ecosystem services. It includes the biodiversity. The third is the development, health and human security. And maybe that part is maybe more social science than the other ones. And the last chapter, it's a more prospective chapter. It's managing future risk and building resilience with the best practice for adaptation, mitigation, and sustainable development to show the knowledge gaps and the needs for research and observation, and to propose a better Mediterranean cooperation and networking for building resilience, and also training and capacity building. And as for IPCC, we will have a summary for policymakers, which will be validated by the representatives of the government. And now I show you the some statistics about the authors of the report. You see here the composition, it's about 68 authors. 25 are from the southern and eastern Mediterranean, and the rest for the north. And you see Spain, Italy, France, and Greece are the most important providers of authors. But we have also a good contribution from Morocco, Tunisia, and all the Cyprus also, the Cyprus Institute in particular, Algeria, Turkey, Egypt, Lebanon. We try to equilibrate the origin of the authors. It's not always easy. And we try also to equilibrate also the gender, to have also female and male authors. At the moment, it's more 60-40. And also in the science, to have a good equilibrium in the different science, especially for the social science. Okay, thank you very much.
The carbon capture technologies would be or would risk to be an excuse to relax, because I feel this risk that if we are starting investing in that, everything we should do in our responsibility could be managed with a relaxed, let's say, approach.
Yeah, you're right, it could be, but I think that at the moment the problem is so huge that it's impossible to ignore the possibility to do that, because it's clear that it's not possible to limit the emission with a sufficient speed to maintain the warming at 1.5 or 2 degrees. This, we need to do that. But you're right, it's a danger to do.
Have a solution that is a technical solution, it might be that let's say more ethical solution will be neglected.
Yeah, it is a limit for forestation, because in fact it's in competition with the food production. If you afforest the region which are good for crops, it's a conflict. It's the same for the biomass energy. If you produce energy from crops, from canned or maize and so on, it's also a limit for the food supply. This, I think that it's really an important problem to have a good approach, and I think that you know more about that than me.
I to wait until to get the microphone, especially because we have the
thank you for the nice overview. I was wondering, so the key challenge is to go from, or to avoid to go from 1.5 to 2 degrees, and you mentioned the dire consequences of, and the benefits of actually not going to 2 degrees and staying to 1.5, which is half a degree difference. Has anyone quantified what has happened, what are the consequences to the world and the humanity by going to 0 to 1 degree? Because you said now we are plus 1 degree warming. So what were the dire consequences or the adverse impacts that happened from going to 0 to normal temperature to 1 degree that has happened so far, in order to understand also this rush to go to save half a degree?
Okay, first, half degree seems to be a small amount, but maybe because I am a paleoclimatologist, I can tell you that the difference of temperature between the glacial period and interglacial period like this one, it's 5 degrees. This half degrees is just the tenth of that. And there is some studies which has shown the difference between, by just looking the past in the period where the warming was 0.5 and 1 degree, we have already a difference of 0.5. The paper showed that it is already a significant difference between the two levels. And to that, we have to add the fact that it's not necessarily linear between 1.5 and 2 degrees. In some sectors, like the corals, for example, we can have something like a tipping point where it's possible to have irreversibility of the change. And in fact, everything is not linear. This is a problem. We don't know everything about that, but it's a problem.
George, are there questions also for the...
Kostas Papanikolas from the Cyprus Institute. I had the opportunity to hear more or less the same thing by Dr. Lee, the head of IPCC, a couple of weeks ago, so I had a little bit of time to think about it. My comment would be the opposite direction. It looks like the report is too conservative to highlight the risks. You already made a comment which is relevant here, that 1.5 degree, it's a global average. It's documented in the report that certain, and in your presentation, that certain areas, for example, the Mediterranean or the Middle East, are accelerating faster than that, and it looks like 1.5 degrees is past history now. But the polar regions are accelerating even faster. And the report says, yes, you can capture the carbon and put the genie back in the bottle. How do you ice the melted ice that will have melted from Greenland in this scenario, which I understand is 10 meters that will have, correct me if I'm wrong, not 10 centimeters, 10 meters rise in the sea. The scenario of either climate engineering, geophysical engineering, or carbon sequestration, yes, you may capture CO2, but what do you do with the ice that has melted and the sea rise has risen to 10 meters, I understand. Mm. And since you are a paleoclimatologist, am I correct to remember, this question actually, that when the globe had the similar CO2 content that it has today, the sea was it 40 or 70 meters higher than today? That's a question.
It's true that the sea ice is, and also the continental ice, it's really an irreversible situation. If one of the scenario I have not mentioned that it's the overshoot scenario. We accept the idea that it's possible to go to more than 1.5 or more than 2 degrees during a short period of time, maybe 10 to 20 or 30 years, and after to go back to 1.5 or 2 degrees according to the capacity we are able to do. And in this case, it's true that there is some irreversible consequence. And for example, in biodiversity also, the species which has disappeared, it's not possible to come back with them. And your last question was finally?
When we had the similar CO2 content in the atmosphere. That has happened before, but the sea level was much higher. And my question, since it's your expertise, how much higher was it at this CO2 level?
Yeah, there is for the sea level, there is a very big uncertainty.
The historical record, I'm not asking the forecast, the historical record. When we had the CO2 content in the atmosphere, if I remember, it was 70 meters higher.
During the glacial period, it was 120 meters lower. But
higher.
No, it's higher than in the glacial period, you mean?
No, in the, I believe it was a Caribbean era, that we had similar CO2 content as today.
You mean for the previous period, warmer period,
yes.
In fact, yeah. For the, I don't know exactly all the numbers, but for the Imian period, it was 120,000 years ago. The temperature was about 2 degrees more than now, and the level was about 7 meters higher than now.
Seven
meters, yeah.
I want to remember to remind the attendees online that they can make question by typing the questions and then we will read it here. I don't know if there are any. Okay. So if there are not questions, I think we could stop until 10 o'clock. That is when we should start the next one to keep the presentations on time. Thank you to all of you. Thank you very much.